Welcome to the results call of ICICI Prudential Life Insurance Company for the financial year 2019. At the outset, I want to apologize to all of you for starting this call about 15-20 minutes late. Sorry about this. We had to finish all our board process and everything. It took a little bit of time. Once again, apologies. So I have with me here, as always, my colleagues, Puneet Nanda, our Deputy Managing Director, and Satyan Jambunathan, our Chief Financial Officer. To begin with, I'd like to highlight that as required by the SEBI Listing Obligations and Disclosure Requirements Regulation, read along with Securities Contract Regulation Rules, the company has met the minimum public shareholding requirements of 25% of the share capital during the quarter ended March 2019. During the last quarter, Prudential Corporation Holding Limited divested 3.71% shareholding in the company as offer for sale through the exchange mechanism route. So with that, our public float requirement has been completed. I would also like to inform you that the board has recommended a final dividend of Rs. 1.55 per share, which translates to about 40% of the profit after tax, excluding the dividend distribution tax for H2 of financial year 2019. The dividend proposal, of course, is subject to shareholders' approval. I'll now talk about the key highlights of our performance for fiscal 2019, along with our key strategic imperatives. We have put up the results of the results presentation on our website. You can refer to it as we walk you through our performance. After my remarks, Satyan will discuss the performance in greater detail. At the end, Puneet, Satyan and I will be happy to take any questions that you may have. As I mentioned in the previous calls, we had set ourselves the objective of growing the absolute value of new business, that is VNB, through the 4P strategy of premium growth, protection business growth, persistency improvement, and productivity improvement targeted at improving cost ratios. We believe this 4P strategy is appropriate in the context of the huge insurance opportunity in the country, coupled with our objective to grow the VNB. If you recall, at 9 months 2019 fiscal year, we had spoken specifically regarding the two immediate priorities, that is premium growth and persistency improvement. We had undertaken some initiatives to address these two immediate priorities, even as we stayed course on our medium-term strategy to take advantage of the huge insurance opportunity presented by our country. So the first priority we had set was to bring back the growth momentum. You would recall that our APE had declined 4.2% during 9 months of fiscal 2019. We had put in place various initiatives, such as engagement with key distributors serving the affluent customers, and distribution and product initiatives to widen our customer base. We believe that these initiatives are required to make our business model more resilient in the medium term and not just to address the immediate priorities. You would have already seen some of the results of these initiatives reflect in the monthly new business trends that we reported over the quarter. I'm happy to report that the new business APE for Q4 of 2019 fiscal grew by 11% on a year-on-year basis. With this, the APE for fiscal 2019 was Rs. 77.99 billion. During the fourth quarter in the last year, we had aligned the definition of group term APE with other industry players. Adjusted for the impact of change in APE definition for the base period, the growth rate for Q4 of fiscal 2019 was 14%, and for the month of March 2019 alone, adjusted for this base effect, it was 15% on a year-on-year basis. So while we ended the year flat on the APE basis, we step into the new financial year with a positive quarterly growth momentum as we move forward. As I mentioned, in order to set up a platform for long-term resilient and sustainable growth, we had embarked on a journey of broadening our customer base. Our number of savings new business policies grew at 19% on a year-on-year basis for the fourth quarter financial year 2019. Now moving on to our second immediate priority, which was to improve persistency. This, I want to assure you that it continues to be a key focus area for the management. We had seen some decline in the 13th month persistency as of December 2018. If you recall, we had mentioned that persistency of high average premium segment has been particularly impacted given the difficult market environment. We intensified our communication to both our distributors as well as to our customers to address any concerns about the environment that they may have had. Some of this worked well for us during the quarter, with our 13-month persistency improving to 86.1% from 84.1% that we had reported at December 2018. We also saw our 49th month persistency improving further to 64% at the end of March 2019. Now, even as these immediate priorities were getting addressed, we continue to make significant progress on our protection journey. As you are aware, our country's demographics, coupled with the low insurance coverage, provide a large untapped opportunity for protection business. With our focus on retail business and building partnerships, our protection new business received premium has multiplied sevenfold within a span of 3 years. During fiscal 2019, it more than doubled to 21.4 billion rupees. Protection business now constitutes more than 20% of our new business received premiums compared to 11% in the previous financial year. If you look at it on an APE basis, protection now accounts for 9.3% of our overall APE. As we have discussed in the past, the protection business, if managed well, can be more profitable than the savings business. Our focus on this customer need, along with our strong risk management practices to ensure sustained profitability, has resulted in a robust growth in our value of new business over the last few years. This has also resulted in the share of VNB from our protection business, the total VNB, growing steadily. With great satisfaction, we see the VNB from protection business now accounting for more than half of our overall VNB. We believe that we are now well on our way to diversify our sources of profits. With protection VNB constituting 60% of our VNB, and with the growth in the protection business being robust, we now see our VNB growth being less susceptible to just the growth of our savings line of business. Along with our efforts to further broaden our customer franchise, we believe that we are well positioned for the future in this regard. I would now like to summarize the performance review for the quarter by saying that we returned to the growth path, we made significant strides in protection business in terms of both top line and the value, and maintained the quality of overall business of the company. These were, to me, three highlights for the quarter. Now, to briefly talk about our performance for the year as a whole, we have ended the year with a slightly positive growth of APE, fueled by a 62% growth in the protection APE. The 13-month persistency stands at 86.1%. Consequently, our margin for the year stands at 17%, with the VNB at rupees 13.28 billion. As we always do, we have made annual disclosures on embedded value. Those are again put up in our presentation. Our embedded value increased to 216.23 billion rupees as on March 2019, a growth of 15.1% over the fiscal year. Pre-dividend embedded value has actually grown by 20%. Embedded value operating profit for fiscal 2019 was 38.01 billion rupees, with the return on embedded value at 20.2%. So with this, I would like to conclude my opening remarks by articulating our agenda for financial year 2020. As we begin the fiscal year, we continue on the path that we had set for ourselves. We seek to grow the VNB through the 4P strategy of premium growth, protection business growth, persistency improvement, and productivity improvement targeted at improving the expense ratios. On the first P of premium growth, we have discussed our strength in the affluent customer base, which we will seek to defend. We have also discussed our desire to broaden the customer base so that we can increase penetration in underserved customer segments. We will pursue this through a variety of initiatives spanning across both distribution channel initiatives and product initiatives. Our focus across channels will be to enhance our current distribution. We intend to do this through a closer mapping of distribution segments with the customer segments and products. We will also work at expanding our distribution network through acquisition of new partners, as well as investing in creation of new sourcing channels. We also believe that the annuity business is a very significant opportunity as more people seek to provide for incomes post-retirement. The key consideration for this business is to ensure that we do not take disproportionate investment risks. We will continue to provide solutions to customers to meet this need while ensuring that we manage balance sheet risks appropriately. Now, moving on to the second P of protection business growth, I spoke earlier of the progress we made on this journey over the years and that it now accounts for 60% of our VNB. We will endeavor to continue on this path during the coming year across both retail and as well as the group lines of business. On the third P of persistency improvement, we have seen marked improvement in the early persistency buckets across the years. As we go forward, we seek to drive similar improvements across all cohorts. Coming to the fourth P of productivity improvement, we will continue to leverage technology to improve cost ratios. We have been an early adopter in this area and will continue to raise the bar. I believe that the enhanced use of emerging areas such as artificial intelligence, data lake, and cloud hosting of applications will improve customer and distributor experience and bring greater risk control and efficiency to our business, as well as efficiency and productivity improvement to our distributors. Given the opportunity that we see in the market and our 4P strategy to leverage this opportunity, we have set ourselves an aspiration to double our VNB over the next 3 to 4 years. I thank you for your attention, and I now hand over to Satyan to discuss the results in greater detail. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Kannan. Good evening. Our strategy continues to be to create value for our stakeholders, namely customers, employees, and shareholders. With our customer-centric approach, we have seen improvement across service parameters. Our claim settlement ratio has increased from 97.9% in FY18 to 98.6% for FY19. Average time taken for settling of a claim was 2.3 days in FY2019. Our grievance ratio as well has improved to 72 per 10,000 policies sold during the year. On the people side, we're currently a 14,000 plus strong organization. Over 90% of our top managers have been with us for more than 10 years. Our approach of building a talent pool has led to about 70% of our top managers having varied job experience within our organization. For our shareholders, our primary focus continues to be to grow the absolute value of new business through the 4P strategy of premium growth, protection business growth, persistency improvement, and productivity improvement targeted at improving cost ratios. On premium growth, as Kannan mentioned, our immediate priority was to grow in Q4. For Q4, we have registered a growth of 11%, resulting in the overall numbers for FY2019 being flat. As we had mentioned earlier, we had aligned the method of measurement of group term APE with the rest of the industry during Q4 2018. Adjusted for this, the growth rate for Q4 was 14% year on year. Our endeavor is to continue this growth momentum into the next year as well. We continue with our focus on retail business, which contributed to more than 95% of our APE. When we look at our growth across product categories, we find that all segments have grown in Q4. For the year, unit-linked products continued to be our mainstay with a mix of about 80%. Non-participating savings segment has also seen significant growth during the year on the back of our continued focus on immediate annuities business. In fact, our immediate annuity business has doubled during the year from 3.11 billion in FY18 to 6.85 billion of single premium. This translates into an APE of 0.69 billion for FY2019. Protection continued to register growth with an APE of rupees 7.22 billion for FY2019, with a protection mix at 9.3% of APE. On the distribution channels, we have continued to invest across channels such as agency, bank assurance partnerships, proprietary sales force, corporate agents and brokers, including web aggregators. It is encouraging to know that all key channels have grown in Q4 2019. For financial year 2019, bank insurance had the strongest growth at 7%. We have a well-diversified distribution mix with non-promoter channels contributing around half of our FY2019 APE. The growth in the group business APE has been mainly driven by protection. A second strategic element of protection. As Kannan mentioned, we increased our focus on protection since 2016. Various initiatives have been undertaken resulting in the growth of the segment at a multiple of the savings growth over the past few years. We are pleased to see the momentum continue during the year with a protection APE growth of 62%. Within the protection business, the retail business contributes more than 60% of our APE. It is important to note that with longer tenure and greater granularity, retail protection products tend to be more profitable. During the year, we have seen APE growth as being volatile across the months. However, the protection APE growth was robust and consistent. Overall, over the last two quarters now, we have seen protection contributing to about 10% or more of our new business APE. Within the protection business, credit life is an area where we have been building partnerships over the past few years. While we have gained a lot of traction in retail protection, on credit life, we primarily operated with ICICI Bank. Over the past few years, we have been building partnerships, which has now resulted in credit life multiplying over 9 times over the last 3 years. In fact, in the last year, it's more than doubled to 15.14 billion. Even after this growth in the credit life business, the third party segment contributes under 14% of our protection APE. In partnership with ICICI Bank, we have worked on delivering a competitive product proposition to its customers, which has helped us deepen penetration in their portfolio as well. The third element of persistency. We believe that customer retention is probably the most effective indicator of the quality of sale and is a barometer of customer experience. At December 2018, we had seen some decline in the 13-month persistency. With focus on building the confidence of our policyholders and encouraging them to pay the renewal premiums, 13-month persistency improved during Q4 and was stable at about 86.1% at March 2019. 25th-month persistency is marginally lower compared to the last year. It is still better than the assumptions which are embedded in our profitability, and we continue to work on improving this. All other cohorts have seen a meaningful improvement in persistency. Consequent to our focus on persistency, our retail renewal premium grew by about 16% to $202 billion in FY2019. Beyond the 49th month, surrenders is a key, and our focus on ensuring that the customer gets the full intended benefit, which also feeds into improving profitability for the company, has resulted in a decline of surrenders by about 20% year on year. Even from a profitability perspective, our persistency and surrender experience continues to be better than what is factored into VNB and EV. The fourth element of cost ratios. Improving productivity within all parts of the organization from sales to service has resulted in our overall cost ratios coming down over the years. As we redouble our focus on protection, we are also conscious that we will have to continue to invest in this segment, resulting in some potential increase in cost ratios. The decline of 4% in the savings business against what we had started the year at the planned growth affected our cost ratio for the year adversely. Our overall cost to total weighted received premium moved from 13.7% in fiscal 18 to 15% for fiscal 19. Within our cost initiatives, on the technology front, multiple initiatives across the product lifecycle are undertaken regularly. In fact, some of the leading industry-leading initiatives, namely customer profiler, instant reader, WhatsApp interface, are some things that we have implemented during the year. The outcome of our focus on these four P's has resulted in a value of new business of $13.28 billion for financial year 2019 compared to $12.86 for financial year 18. The VNB margin is 17% as compared to 16.5% for the last year. The change in margin from 16.5% to 17% is contributed through the following. First, the favorable business mix, primarily on account of protection growth, has led to an improvement of margins by 2.2%. Assumption changes improved the margins by a further 0.9%. However, higher acquisition cost ratios, as we just discussed, resulted in a deterioration of 2.6% in the margin. Overall, the embedded value increased by 15.1% to $216.23 billion at March 2019. Pre-dividend embedded value grew by 20% over last year. Within this, in particular, the value of the in-force business grew by 21% to $142.69 billion at March 2019. The growth in the value of in-force is primarily led by VNB and is also supported by positive operating variances. Embedded value operating profit for the year was $38.01 billion. VNB continues to be a significant share of EVOP. Operating variances, namely persistency, mortality, morbidity, and expense, continued to be positive for the year. Our return on embedded value stands at 20.2% for FY2019. The operating assumption change that I described in the margin and what is there in the EV is predominantly due to the true-up of the effective tax rate for the year, a reduction in the maintenance expenses given the improvement in scale, and a reduction in surrender rates beyond 5 years for unit link, some of which we have reflected now in the assumptions. The next slide presents the embedded value development over the last 3 years. We continue to maintain the positive variances across all the operating parameters, which gives us confidence on our assumptions that are built into both the VNB and the embedded value computation. When we look at the sensitivity across last year and this year for both VNB and EV, given the increased contribution of protection, the sensitivity to mortality rates has increased significantly. Other sensitivities continue to be fairly stable. The VNB and EV sensitivity to acquisition expenses also has increased during the year on account of the higher cost ratio that I mentioned. The profit after tax for 2019 was 11.41 billion compared to 16.2 billion for FY18. This drop in profit is explained by an increase in the new business strain, resulting from strong growth in the protection and the annuity segment, which have been and continue to be our focus areas. The new business strain of the protection and annuity products is significantly higher than that of the savings products, while it is margin accretive. Solvency ratio continues to be strong at 215%. Given this, the board has recommended a final dividend of 1.55 per share, which translates to about 40% of the profit after tax, excluding dividend distribution tax, for H2 FY2019. To summarize, we continue to monitor ourselves on the 4P framework of premium growth, protection business growth, persistency improvement, and productivity improvement to improve expense ratios. Our performance on these dimensions is what we expect to feed into our VNB growth aspirations over time. Thank you, and we are now happy to take any questions that you may have.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, we will now begin the question and answer session. Anyone who wishes to ask a question may please press star, then 1 on their touchtone telephone. If you wish to remove yourself from the question queue, you may press star, then 2. Participants are requested to use handsets while asking a question. Ladies and gentlemen, we will wait for a moment while the question queue assembles. To ask a question, please press star, then 1. The first question is from the line of Amay Sathe from Tata Mutual Fund. Please go ahead.
Hi, sir. Two questions from my side. One is on your advertisement and publicity expenses. So around 280 crore for this quarter and around 670 of year for the year. How do you measure the productivity of such a large expense?
We've said this in our past results as well. As we are going on the path of improving our protection business, it is quite important for us to improve awareness. And part of that journey is to advertise across a variety of medium. Some is above the line, a lot of it also is below the line and local level so that we can increase awareness. Even at these levels of expenses, it is fully factored into the profitability for the protection business. And therefore, it ends up being value accretive. I think it is unavoidable that we spend on advertising because without awareness, we cannot make many meaningful progress on the protection sector.
Okay. So, this current trend will continue this level of expenditure on advertisement?
Yes, we will expect the advertising expenses at least for the foreseeable future to be at these levels.
Okay, got it. And the second question on this target of doubling the VNB in next 3 years. So, how much of it will be driven by the margin improvement? So, where do you see your margins of this 70% currently in, say, next 3 years, and what will be drivers of those margin improvement?
So, we have always looked at our business growth in absolute VNB, not just with respect to margins. But having said that, a big driver of the growth in VNB will come from the new business growth as well. Along with that, of course, as our protection business continues in terms of improving the mix from the roughly 10% that we are at, will be a key contributor for the margin expansion.
So just to correct my way, I said in the opening remarks that we will double the VNB into 3 to 4 years. That is what I had mentioned.
Yeah.
And secondly, that the path towards that will continue to be the 4Ps, as we said. We would like to press all the 4 levers as we move forward. As Satyan mentioned, a good part of this will be played by the premium growth as well as the protection growth. That is the way we are looking at it in terms of expansion of our VNB.
Okay. Great, sir. Thanks a lot and best of luck for the FY20.
Thank you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Nidesh Jain from Investec. Please go ahead.
Thanks for the opportunity, sir. Sir, in the EV walk, can you explain why there is a very high operating assumption change variance? So what exactly we have changed, what assumptions we have changed in this year?
The operating assumption change,
just to put the numbers, if I remember the number earlier, last year it was actually almost double of this number, 7 point something. Yeah. So to that extent, if you compare the same number for the last year, it has actually reduced from 7 billion rupees plus to 4.2 billion rupees. So Satyan can take us through the components of where all it has gone. He mentioned it a little bit in his remarks, but I'll ask him to talk about this.
So Nitesh, the key elements are, one, we always true up the effective tax rate given the current year. Second, given the improvement in persistency, our maintenance costs per unit have been declining. That is reflected into the future because we do it on an actual cost basis projected into the future. The third is that on the unit-linked business, beyond 5 years, we have again spoken about it, that our persistency has been improving, surrender rates have been coming down. Some of that we have taken into the operating, into the assumption change. Even after the assumption change, you will notice that the persistency variance has improved from the last year to 2.66 for this year. So while we have taken some of it, we still think there is an opportunity to, over the next few years, even if we maintain the current experience, that some of it should start flowing into margin and EV.
And we are quite sensitive to the fact that the other operating variances, we would like to keep it in the positive territory. That is something which will be factoring in terms of our assumption changes going forward as well.
Thanks for that. So first on taxation, so we have further reduced our tax rate assumption this year versus the last year?
No assumption. This is based on the trends of effective tax rate. So what we, from the financials, will be able to get, so there is some reduction in the effective tax rate this year. That is what is reflected. But that is not the biggest part.
Sure, sure. And on persistency, just to clarify, there is no change in the lapsation assumptions for 13-month or 26-month. It's just the surrender assumption that we take after 5th year. There we have made a change.
That is correct.
Yeah, especially the Nidesh, that we have seen the development of the early buckets over the course of last 4 quarters. In those early buckets, we would like to observe the trend for some more time. So that is why we have not really released anything there.
Sure, sure. And on the mortality side, we have seen quite a bit of improvement in operating variance. So any thought on taking that in assumption changes over a period of time? Or?
So right now, Nidesh, what you're seeing is on a larger sum assured book, you're seeing that being reflected. So we'll just wait to see mortality experience stabilize over a period of time before we make any meaningful changes.
Because it has almost more than doubled on a YOY basis, I think.
Yes, in fact, the overall sum assured itself has grown at over 40%. So a large part of this is coming from the book expansion also.
And to understand this higher acquisition cost, which has impacted margins negatively, is the growth, lower growth in saving business the reason, or is something else is the reason for this higher acquisition cost?
Lower growth in the savings business is the main reason.
Which we had articulated, Nitesh, in the last quarter also when we put out the numbers. There are queries around why we are marking the margin at 17%. This only on account of that.
Sure, sure. And if you look at 9-month margin and full year margin, again, there is no much change, while protection share has again improved. And we have also done these operating assumption changes. So how we should look at the margins for 9 months and full year?
If even at 9 months, if you recollect, we had said that we were projecting for a roughly flat new business, and that's what is reflected. The protection mix has improved a little bit from then to the fourth quarter, but it's nothing other than what we had projected.
Okay, okay. So this is, to understand that basically there is a slightly higher acquisition expense versus what we have projected for the 9 month.
Slightly in the last quarter.
Sure.
Yes.
Sure. Okay, sir. That's it for my side. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks, Vijay.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Dhaval Gada from DSP Mutual Fund. Please go ahead.
Hi. Thanks for the additional disclosure. Just three questions. First, Kanan, if you could, like you've shared guidance around VNB, absolute VNB growth, could you also sort of share some thoughts around the protection premium, which is about 722 crore, where this number could be maybe next 3 to 4 years' time? Could it more than double or so? Some color there. The second question was to Satyan on protection margins. I see, you know, from 18 to 19, there has been some correction in protection margin from 124 to 109%. So some thoughts around what's driving that. And the third question was, could you comment a little bit on what is the absolute level of new business strain in FY19? Yeah, thanks.
Thanks, Dhaval.
Thank you. On the first question, Dhaval, you had asked regarding this protection. Yes, the number came out at a little over 7 billion rupees for financial year 2019. While I have talked about doubling the VNB as a company in 3 to 4 years, we have not specifically mentioned anything about a particular product mix or anything. But to answer your question, I would say that the expectation among us here is that the protection business APE will continue to grow ahead of the savings and the overall company APE growth. That is something which we can say. And as a result, we can also say that the protection protection mix in our overall APE will keep growing from there. So beyond that, we have not really put a specific number on only the protection line of business growing to a particular amount. Satyan, you can talk.
Never to answer your question on the protection margins, the composition of protection business, as you would have noticed, the group protection business grew faster. The margin is just a reflection of what is happening on the relative mix between the individual protection and the group protection business.
So how much is group today? Sorry, if you could just remind.
So 60% of the protection APE is retail, the rest is group.
Okay, and this in FY18 was?
FY18 was, group was lower.
Okay, okay.
So if you look at our slide number, I think 21, we have given the breakout this time, very clearly, both for FY18 as well as for FY19. So that we thought that since there have been queries, we thought we should make out make sure. This disclosure as well.
I'll take a look. Yeah, sure. And the third question was around the new business strain. What is the number for FY19?
FY19, we have not disclosed the P&L breakup separately. Level.
Okay, okay, fine. Okay, thanks. All the best.
Thank you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Adarsh Parasrampuria from Nomura. Please go ahead.
Hi, just joined the call a little late, so if you can just clarify what were the assumption changes. Sorry about that.
No problem.
Drawing up for effective tax rate, reflecting the current lower maintenance unit expenses and some change in the surrender rates beyond 5 years. Not all of the improvement, but some of the improvement that we are seeing.
And the persistency dip and then the improvement in, versus 9-month number, that still remains, you've not moved on that.
No change to assumption on that.
Understood. Thanks, man. This is helpful. That's about it. Yeah.
Thank you.
The next question is from the line of Nitin Agarwal from Motilal Oswal. Please go ahead.
Yeah, hi. Thanks for the opportunity. I have a couple of questions. My first question is, like, how much of this persistency improvement this quarter was driven by the buoyancy in markets during the quarter? We understand that you have taken efforts to educate and make customers more informed, which has driven this improvement. But just want to understand that how sustainable this improvement is, and is there any scope to increase it further? And second question is on the solvency ratio. That number has come up by nearly 40% this year. So what is the threshold level that we have beyond which we will look to increase the same?
I'm requesting DMT Puneet to answer this question.
Persistency, we always said, is a combination of several factors. Of course, the market environment is important, but it's not the only factor. A lot of other factors come into play in terms of how we drive our own people, how we drive our agents, how we communicate to the customers, etc., etc. So in my view, the improvement is a combination of all of these things. If you noticed, our persistency actually over the first 9 months actually was a little lower. So it's not as if the market was buoyant only in Q4. I'm not saying it has not helped, it has helped, but I don't think that is a very significant thing. It's a combination of all the other things which has played out. And indeed, as we've been saying, our overall persistency improvement, if I see over the last 5 years, is actually a combination of all of these things. And in 5 years, we have seen full cycles in the market. Second, Satyan.
So what is the second question? Sorry. Solvency, okay. Solvency is at 215%. Again, some of the drop in solvency is driven by the dividend payouts during this year. We don't have a hard threshold on solvency, but when it gets close to 200% is when we will evaluate ways of conserving or maybe raising alternate capital to support growth.
Okay. Thanks so much. Thanks.
Thanks.
The next question is from the line of Avinash Singh from SBI Cap Securities. Please go ahead.
Yeah, hi. Two questions. First one on, like, if I look in your GAAP or accounting profit, a large part of year-on-year decline has been driven by, as you said, new business trade. So if I look at the segmental surplus, of course, non-par is showing a swing of close to 450-500 crores, largely maybe on account of a strong growth in protection and corresponding expenditure. Now that base had been set, you have this alternate base. Going forward, I mean, looking to FY20, what kind of a sort of a this trend in the segmental surplus or deficit in this and overall sort of accounting profit would you see? I mean, of course, assuming normalized growth rate of what you say, typically 15%. So that is one, some color on that non-par segmental surplus deficit. And second, when you are disclosing this, that's a good disclosure, the margin for saving and protection. I mean, how has been the cost, particularly different costs related to acquisition allocated? Because, I mean, if I'm not wrong, a large part of your ad and publicity spend that you have done in the last 12 months would be more towards protection. So how has that, some of the common costs, I mean, allocated while sort of disclosing this or calculating this margin? These are my two questions. Thank you.
Okay. Avinash, with respect to the segmental profit, it's very hard to say what it will be. But at an overall profit, this year with about 11.4 billion, our endeavor is to see how we can keep this stable from here on. But of course, a big part of it will be determined by how much the growth of protection and annuity business happens over next year. So segmental, I don't know, but at an overall level, the idea is to try to keep it as stable as possible within the growth parameters. The second question that you asked with respect to the cost allocation across savings and protection. You're right. A bulk of our advertising has been on protection. The way we recognize the cost is that anything which is directly attributable to a segment is recorded for that segment. And therefore, all of the protection expenses are accounted for in the protection VNB.
Thank you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Rahul Gupta from Morgan Stanley. Please go ahead.
Yeah, hi, Sumit here. Three questions from my side. First is, what would be the cost growth in savings lines of business? So I see the cost ratio has come down on a YOY basis. I just wanted to check the absolute cost growth in savings business.
So we haven't given that, but the sense of it you get, Sumit, from the margin. The 2.6% drop in the margin is predominantly driven by higher cost ratios for savings.
No, because, okay, because the question that I was trying to get an answer for is, assuming the product mix doesn't change for fiscal 19, when do we start seeing, at what level of growth do we start seeing impact of higher acquisition costs? In a sense, take for example, if you're growing premiums by 10% next year, does that mean that the savings ones are not coming down? Adjusted for assuming the same product mix, will that be a... So that number, what is that 10% number, is what I'm trying to get to.
Assuming at a broad level, what we are capacitized as an organization is definitely some growth into next year, even where we are now. So the challenge that we have had on growth, if we are able to reverse that into next year, we should automatically see at least some efficiency on the cost ratios come through.
Do you have any further questions?
Sorry, I actually missed the response. The line got disconnected.
What I was saying is that as an organization, we think we are capacitized for growth into next year as well. If we are able to reverse the lack of growth in the last year into fiscal 20, then we should expect to see some improvement in the cost ratio come through into the margin.
Okay. Got it. Second question is on retail protection growth. So that's very strong at 60%. How should we think about that number going forward? And what's driving that 60% growth? Is there new channels? If you can elaborate that, it'll help us think about that number over the next 2-3 years.
So, Sumit, as we said, protection, we have three broad lines, retail, credit life, and group term. So 61% is on overall. Within that, of course, retail has also grown 61%, but the bigger growth, so an absolute number is small, is coming from credit life and a decent growth in group term. It's, I think, been a combination of product, distribution, and efficiencies. All of the three things have worked because the customer need under penetration was always there. I think if I look at it top down demographically, that need remains, and you know, given the level of under penetration, we can still continue to grow at a good rate. Having said that, some amount of product innovation will have to continue in terms of differentiation and in terms of sometimes even getting to certain specific needs. This is on the retail side. On the credit life side, it's, as you know, more a B2B2C business. There, it's more a question of how many more partners we can tie up with. We did tie up with a lot of partners last year. We got that benefit this year. That, of course, will continue, but we have further tied up with several more partners this year. We will continue to get that benefit next year as well. So, as you said, overall protection growth should be higher than the savings as well as the total company growth rate.
Okay, and final question is on the operating variance. And in that, mortality and morbidity is doing very well. There was quite a bit of improvement in fiscal 19 versus fiscal 18. Any color on that as to why is it doing so well?
The mortality is improved because of two factors. One, the book itself has become larger, and therefore we are seeing, even on a proportionality, you will get a higher absolute variance. Second, of course, is that a lot of the credit life business is in the very early period. And therefore, in the early period, usually you will see a better experience come through. So this is still something that we would watch very closely to see how it develops over a period of time and then how we can reflect it.
So it would be fair to assume that apart from the absolute number change which will happen because the business has grown, on the retail protection side, that number is kind of stable? The percentage number is kind of stable?
Experience is stable, largely, yes.
Yeah, experience is stable. Okay. Okay, that's it from my side. Thank you.
Thanks, Amit.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Sanket Goda from Spark Capital. Please go ahead.
Yeah, thanks for taking my question. Two questions I had. This 4.2 billion operating variance, assumption changes which we have made, can we break down or quantify it into tax, maintenance cost, and surplus?
We haven't given the breakup. Okay.
Yep. Or bulk would be because of the surrenders?
Maintenance expenses will be the big part.
Okay, the big part would be the maintenance cost.
Yeah, which is improving efficiency because it's about actual costs.
Okay, just to confirm again, so the assumptions what we build in EV and VNB, the 13-month, the first 5-year cohort, we have not changed it, right? We have maintained what we have been reporting in FY18.
That's correct. We confirm that, yeah.
Okay, and lastly, the economic variance numbers, if I see the yield curve, G-Sec yield curve, still for the March 19, March 19 is lower than the March 18 number. We still, because of the positive change in the bond prices, our negative economic variance has been reported for the full year. So just wanted to understand any specific reason why we have an economic or investment variance negative for the full year?
At a point on the yield curve, there is an improvement in the yields, but I think at an aggregate level, the shape of the yield curve has changed quite significantly. And what you see as an outcome of economic variance is actually driven by, for each of the portfolios, where my average durations are.
And finally, on just the protection business, how you see this mix overall shaping up? So right now the retail is almost 60% of the total protection. Given the credit protection, the group protection has grown at a better pace than the retail protection. So the mix would be moving ahead in the favor of group protection. And also within the retail protection, just wanted to understand whether this 4.36 billion, how much would be riders contributing to it?
First of all, there's hardly any riders there. Second, from a relative mix between these two, Sanket, it's very hard to predict that. It's not as if we are setting a constraint on where the growth should come from. It's really about the opportunity. Reality is that retail protection is a very hardworking model. It is very granular and only grows in a systematic fashion. So that emergence, we will have to see how it goes. But overall, the protection mix being at 10% or above over the last two quarters, again, gives us confidence that double digit is for the full year is not that difficult.
Okay. Thanks for that. That answers my question.
Thank you.
The next question is from the line of Venkatesh Sanjeev from Pictet. Please go ahead.
Hi, a couple of questions. You mentioned the focus on credit life through the third-party channel, which you are increasing. Can you name some of the new tie-ups which have been taken place in the recent past, and how's the experience been with them?
We have not put out specific names, Venkatesh, but almost most significant lenders, we will have some kind of partnership with them.
Right, but any broad categorization in terms of which segments or which sort of...
HFCs, NBFCs, and banks.
Yeah, I mean, that's the market. I'm just saying, for you, in terms of which one's been contributing, which is doing better.
You asked for categories, right? Just to give you a little bit more color, a large part of our credit life still is ICICI Group only. But the others are improving. We have actually given you some sort of a split on slide number 23.
Right.
Beyond that, for confidentiality reason, it's not fair to speak about specific part.
Okay. The reason why I'm asking this question is that some of your competition has been quite vocal in mentioning they've tied up 200 people, 200 partners and things like that. I'm just wondering, is there sufficient space and sufficient business further for multiple people to be active here?
See, most of these lenders, they tie up with multiple partners. So hardly any relationship on credit life side is going to be exclusive. Because unlike the corporate agency guidelines for bank assurance, where there's a limit of up to 3, here it's a group insurance product, so there's no limit. So today, most, I would say, vast majority of lenders will have multiple tie-ups. So that way there is no constraint.
And the other thing is that, you know, we keep doing an opportunity scan and keep tying up with the partners by the month, by the quarter. You know, that journey continuously is there. And as I mentioned in the context of technology, I have said that one of the key planks of our technology has been to be a facilitator of business even for our distributors. So the integration of our technology, thereby, you know, increasing the productivity for our distributors, that gives a powerful proposition for us to go and make a pitch and tie up with any of these partners. So that our customer experience and the producer experience, the distributor experience, is something which stands us in good stead when we go and pitch and keep tying up with these new partners. So the universe is available, as Puneet said, that you know, our feeling is that we can enter if we want to, given the kind of solution we have, and continuously we keep doing that.
Okay, and my other question was on the margins and protection piece. There was an earlier question also on this, and you had mentioned that the margin drop is mainly because of the shift in the mix between group and the other retail segment. But within let's say retail protection itself or within group, are you seeing any trends? Can you just talk about competition, pricing pressure, and things like that? And also that somebody highlighted to us that the claim rejection ratios have dropped in the individual protection piece. Is that impacting margins?
So within segments, it's been stable. That has not been a challenge. Competitiveness
is always
intense. It is not that it will go away. A lot of our retail protection comes from our own distributor. And therefore, to that extent, whatever advantage a relationship has helps us.
And just to, you know, add to that, in a way, alluding to what Kanan said earlier, look, pricing-wise, competition will always be there. If anything, will always increase. The way we try to differentiate, whether on retail or on credit life, is through superior technology, superior process, and hence greater efficiency, whether it's for the customer or for the distributor. It has worked for us largely. So there's, you know, that gives us encouragement that we can continue to differentiate on that platform.
Is this data right that rejections have come down significantly over the last few years in the individual side?
That information doesn't seem to be publicly available. But I think what the regulator is very keen to ensure is that rejections come down. What the regulator is keen to ensure is that people are more selective at underwriting and do not reject at whims and fancies. That is a very, very clear regulatory direction with respect to claims.
And also, you know, if you think from the larger perspective, we speak about protection being the largest need. I think this is a trust business. And for that, it's actually good that claim payout ratios are improving for everybody in the industry. If anything, it will not just improve trust, it will improve our ability to reach out to more people and convince more people to buy more protection.
And fundamentally, if one is depending on repudiated claims to improve margins, one is putting together a portfolio for disaster.
I mean, I'm sure it will improve the market and the maybe volumes, but at the, I mean, they could have some impact on margins if the pricing
is... The way we are doing the underwriting, the way we have looked at the assumptions, we don't see, you know, this particular issue which you talked about impacting our margins. No, we don't see that.
Okay. All right. Thanks. Thanks so much.
Yeah.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Nitin Rao from Alpha Ideas. Please go ahead.
Thank you, sir, for giving me this opportunity. So my question is that as a company, we seem to have lost our way. Our profits are down by 30%. Our dividend is down by more than 50%. We are losing market share to competition. So my question to the management is, how do we, our market cap valuations are, of, you know, very subdued as compared to the competition. So my question to the management is, what steps will ensure, will take that we go back to our profit winning ways, we go back to increasing dividends, we go back to increasing market share? You know, that's my question actually.
Okay, thank you for asking this question. But as we have always told the market, analysts, investors, we have talked about, given the nature of the industry, clearly we believe that the appropriate profit metric to be looking at would be the value of new business, that we strongly believe in, because of the fact that the policies which we are writing are very long-term policies, and with the protection becoming a bigger percentage, the term is further increasing, and we do not have any ability to amortize the expenses, which ideally should be amortized over a period of time given the benefits arising out of these policies. So given that, we believe that VNB is the approximate, appropriate metric to look at when it comes to the profitability of the business we are writing. That we are absolutely clear about. The second thing, challenge about the PAT is that if you are doing a very highly value-create accretive business such as protection, given the kind of expenses which we talk about in writing this business, it creates a drag when it comes to PAT. But that doesn't mean that we have to ignore that business, because from a shareholder perspective, we believe strongly that it's a very value accretive business. And coupled with that, as I mentioned in my opening remarks, the protection opportunity is huge in the country. So that is how I will stack up, PAT versus VNB debate. That is how I will settle it. So our endeavor, that's why I have mentioned that we want to expand our VNB, and we have put out a sort of an aspiration to say that over a period of 3 to 4 years, we want to actually double our VNB of financial year 2019. So that is what is going to be guiding us. Now coming to your next question regarding dividend, if you really look at the payout ratios in the financial services industry, typically it will be more like a 30% type of a payout. Actually, we are doing a payout which is at a 40% payout is something which we are doing. So I think that in a capital intensive industry where the solvency margins are being looked at, I believe that we should have to calibrate the dividend based on the capital requirements of the company. As far as the market cap is concerned, I wouldn't like to comment on it because it is really in the domain of the investors. But to take your point regarding our growth trajectory, we have articulated in the past, in the last analyst call also, that our endeavor would be to make our business model a little more resilient from a growth perspective by not just protecting our franchise in the highly affluent segments of the market, but also widen our customer base. So we have taken all the steps, including, as I mentioned this time, that there has been a 19% growth on a year-on-year basis in terms of the savings policies sold during the quarter. So the steps towards keeping the growth less volatile
would be to expand the customer base, to look at multiple products to cater to the different segments of the market. That is the journey which has been going on. And as I clearly addressed in my opening remarks, that the two priorities which we are focusing on, one of the key priorities is the coming back to the growth, which I have already articulated, which addresses your point, and we are back to a double-digit growth in the last quarter. So to summarize, we monitor ourselves on the 4P framework of premium growth, protection business growth, persistency improvement, as well as productivity improvement to improve the expense ratios. This will continue to be the guardrails against which we'll operate in expanding our VNB the way I have mentioned. So that is the broad story I want to articulate in the context of your question, and thank you for asking this question.
So to follow up on that, hello?
Yes, go ahead.
Yes, so to follow up on that, see, this year VNB grew by 3%, the profits fell by 30%. Now, if you're saying you'll double the VNB in the next 3 years, will that our profits increase or will they fall further? Because, like you said, it's a very competitive business, it is expensive, and you're looking at the longer run. So, in the shorter run, which is in the next 3-4 years from now, as you acquire new customers, acquire new products, and grow the new business, will it have an impact on the profits? Number one. And number two, you mentioned the dividend payout ratios. What is your official dividend policy? I'd like to know that. Are you saying that going forward, 30% will be a payout or 35%? What is it actually?
Yeah, on the second question, I'll take first, then Satyan can answer your first question regarding the PAT versus VNB equation going forward. On the second question on dividend, our dividend policy says that the board can declare a payout ratio of up to 40% is something which is there in our dividend policy. And we have talked about our solvency ratios, which we have put out at 215%. And Satyan has also mentioned in the context of a previous question on our capital that the board will definitely consider looking at the dividend payout within the contours of the dividend policy, as well as looking at alternative capital raising other than common equity shares before even looking at the common shareholders. So I think that the dividend policy or rather the dividend payout within the dividend policy guidance would be determined by the emerging solvency ratio, which will be determined by the board and recommended to the shareholders.
Surely PATs have a role to play, right, in this? Because if you are showing declining PATs, no, you can pay a higher dividend, or even though you maintain a 30-35% dividend payout ratio, as a shareholder, the amount of money that you get is decreasing.
Yeah, I agree with you, but I can only say at this point in time that our dividend policy clearly says that the payout ratio will be up to 40%.
Okay, great. But please go ahead.
Again, going back to the point that Kannan was talking about earlier on PAT versus VNB, the key really is that it is not that PAT is lower because expense is high. PAT is lower because expenses in insurance is upfronted, whereas the premium is level over a period of time. So it is a timing mismatch that causes that. So what you see as a PAT being lower is not because of lack of efficiency. It is because timing mismatch given the accounting norms between revenue and expenditure. Now that is not something that we can do anything about given that it is there. Now this particular mismatch is different across different products. The relationship to VNB growth and PAT may not be as one-to-one. If I were to go back to historical, FY16, we had a VNB of 4.12 billion. In the last 3 years, it has become more than 3 times. It is now 13.28 billion. That's the kind of growth that we have seen. PAT has been fairly flat for the first 3 years, and this year it dropped. From here on, like I mentioned earlier as well, the endeavor is to keep the PAT stable while we work on growing the value of new business. It is actually, there is not much that we can do about the accounting regime which causes this kind of a mismatch. And that's why we come back to the same point that Kannan mentioned as to what is a truer measure of value creation or profitability or even operating metric in a life insurance company. And that comes back to value of new business and not profit.
Okay. Thank you so much for the clarification. But again, if you have to, let's say, focus on VNB and you look at the competition, they seem to be doing so much better than us. why is that? And what are we, other than protection, is it only because we are not strong in the protection space and we are trying to rectify that now? Is that what you're saying?
The difference in VNB across different companies is a function of how much of new business premium that we are doing and the margin that we are doing it at. What we have clearly focused on is to offer products which are value adding to the customer, and we have used that as a way to expand the market. What you are seeing as a value of new business, therefore, is the combined impact of what we have been able to do from a growth on new business premium in the products that we are selling. Protection, like we mentioned, the mix is lower, but in absolute protection new business on the retail side, we are more than anyone else in the market. Persistency, which is a key driver of profitability, we are better than anyone else in the market. Expense ratio, which is a key driver of profitability, we are as good, if not better than anyone else in the market. So all of the key levers that drive profitability outcomes, we have the best operating parameters. And that is our route to improving profitability.
Okay. So would it...
Yes. May we request you to come back in the queue for a follow-up, please?
Okay, thank you. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, in order to ensure that the management is able to address questions from all participants in this conference call, please limit your questions to two per participant. If you have any further questions, you may come back for a follow-up. The next question is from the line of Sachin Mittal from Kavi Stock Broking. Please go ahead.
Sir, thank you for giving me the opportunity. This particular question is regarding one of the important aspects of income from investments. How do we know if a particular AUM, if the AUM is actually shrinking, particularly for the linked business, how do we know that it's because of the loss or profit on the sale of redemption, or it is because of the transfer or accretion of discount on the fair value changes? What is the measurement on that to actually, given the concern that the shareholder investment table, particularly of 8A, does not mention particularly if a particular line of business, let's say call it a linked life business, if the AUM is decreasing, it is decreasing because the investment has decreased on that particular year, or it's decreasing because of some other reasons. That's one question of all.
Sachin, if you look at the AUM for the linked business, the AUM for linked business actually has grown in the last year. You can see it in one of the in the 8P schedule, which is the unit linked, or you can even see it on the face of the balance sheet where you have linked liabilities and assets backing linked liabilities. That will give you what the AUM is. If you want to see whether the AUM change is coming from flows or market, you can see it from the segmental revenue account for unit linked. The flows will be the premium income less the benefits, whereas AUM market impact will be investment income, including all of the mark-to-market impact which comes through. So you can actually pick it up from the segmental accounts and break it up into where the growth is coming from.
Exactly. So on aggregate basis, I can see that the AUM is increased, but particularly on the line of business side, particularly on linked life side, I don't see that it is actually increasing. It's actually the erosion of the AUM is happening. So I need to say, particularly in these scenarios, how do you consider that? How do you know that particularly for this particular line of business, linked life, is it happening because of fair value changes, or is it because we are incurring a losses in the redemption of the investment at the end of the 5 years?
So that's what I'm telling you. It is there in the segmental. If you so desire, we can connect with you offline and take you through where you can find those respective numbers. It's all there in the segment disclosures. But I can anyway offline have, we will connect with you and take you through this. If you can just drop us a mail, then we will connect back with you.
Thank you.
The next question is on the line of Hitesh Bilati from Haitong Securities. Please go ahead.
Hey, sir, thank you for giving me an opportunity. So my first question is on annuity products. So we mentioned that we have doubled the annuity products. So is there a change in strategy where we are going to look at this product more aggressively? And secondly, you also mentioned that there is new business strain in annuity. So could you just clarify on that, and then I can go on to my further questions?
Yeah,
Yeah, annuity, I just wanted to tell you that it is an inherent part of our strategy to be pushing the pensions and the annuity business. There is no change in strategy. We continue to be focused on this. The bulk of the annuity business we do is the immediate annuity business. Maybe you are referring to a deferred annuity type of a business, which we have said in the past that unless we are absolutely sure about not putting any risk on the balance sheet, we don't want to be aggressive on that business. Having said that, immediate annuity business, we want to be doing it, we have been doing it, and we'll continue to do it. So that has been a part of our inherent pension and annuity strategy, which has resulted in the kind of growth we are talking about. Annuity strain, the way the product is designed, obviously annuity has got a strain, that's what Satyan mentioned earlier. But I want to tell you that if you put the lens of the VNB and the VNB margin, it is definitely accretive to us from a value perspective. So given that, we would continue to be focusing on this business.
I wanted to understand, because it's a single premium product mainly, so how does strain actually sort of come in that scenario, because you get the premiums up then?
The strain comes in because of the way liability has to be held. Liability is always expected to be on a more conservative estimate than on the pricing basis. So let's say, for example, that I have to pay 100 rupees 1 year from now. If I am pricing it assuming an 8% fund earning rate, I will discount at 100 at 8% to arrive at today's price. However, for the purpose of the liability, the regulator may well expect me to reserve at a discount rate lower than 8%. So the moment the 8% becomes a 6%, the present value becomes higher than the premium itself. And that is what gives rise to the new business thing.
Okay, so thank you for that. Secondly, sir, just on the protection AP ticket size, I noticed that the average ticket size has increased from 9,000 to around 12,000. So what can that be due to?
During the third quarter of last year, we started offering a limited pay option in the annuities. The limited pay option in the protection. The limited pay comes at a slightly higher average premium. What you're seeing is as the portfolio average premium is that mix coming through.
Okay, and so just lastly, sir, on the tax rate, so what has actually led to effective tax rate being lower this year than last year?
Flat PAT and higher dividend income.
Okay, so thank you. That's it from my side.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Neeraj Toshniwal from MK Global. Please go ahead.
Hello, sir. So just wanted to understand in terms of product mix and the channel, are we changing strategy because seeing PAR doing more from the agency now rather than the banker channel? Slide 50.
Yes, sir. What was the question again?
Any change in strategy? Participatory products are coming more from the agency channel now. I mean, rather than the banker. I mean, meaningful change over there. So any change in strategy? Slide 50.
Doing a distributor-led business, we give the choice of the products to the distributors. We keep available all the products in our portfolio, and depending on the profile of the customers and the distribution, what they want to sell, it gets picked up. So that is the philosophy we have used, and what you are seeing in terms of the mix percentage is the resultant of that strategy rather than pushing something to a particular channel or not.
Okay, got your point. And on the average ticket size of ULIP after change of towards lower ticket size and monthly ULIPs, what has been the trend and how it has been shaping up?
We've actually put out the quarter wise average premium on slide number 47. That will show you where the average premiums are stabilizing over the last couple of quarters.
So this is what we've been telling the investors and analysts at the market. That in Q3, when we had this volatility around our premium growth in the month of October, we were focused on diversifying our customer base, and more importantly, the activating the distributors, some of which was freezing up given the market volatility and given the high ticket sizes. That is when, as a part of the overall customer diversification strategy, but more importantly, the immediate activation strategy for the distributor, we introduced this product. There were concerns around it at that point in time to say that is it going to collapse your average premium, and we had clarified during our conversations that it is not that it is going to fall off the cliff, and that there would be some stabilization of the average premium, which will happen over a period of time. I look at this average retail APE per policy numbers, which you have put out on slide 47 with great satisfaction, that
it has pretty much panned out the way we thought, that it will probably stabilize at a particular level, which could be lower, but it will not keep collapsing. So if you look at the ULIP average retail APE per policy in the fourth quarter, actually it has gone up from 134,000 in the previous quarter to 165,000. While it is less than the way we started off the year, but we see that stabilizing around that level. Similarly, there was an earlier question on protection, where it has gone up because of the introduction of the limited pay product to 15,800 rupees in the fourth quarter. Because of which, if you look at the overall basis, while indeed the total average retail APE per policy for a company as a whole has come down from 90,000 rupees to around 83,000 rupees, we saw the trend across the quarters. If you see in the fourth quarter, it was about 87,700 rupees. So this has been a part of the conscious strategy of activating the distribution at the same time, you know, average premium stabilizing at a particular level. So that, you know, we believe that we have, you know, that the strategy which we have thought about has played out quite well on the ground, if you look at this slide.
Great, sir. So last question from my side. Just wanted to understand, I mean, wanted to get some sense actually, because the new business strain is higher as we move into more protection and annuity business, which is very obvious. But can we get some sense in terms of payback period, in terms of difference between the payback from a protection business, that to in a retail and a group versus ULIP, if some granular data we have, or I can take it offline as well?
We can connect offline.
Sure, sir. Thank you so much and all the best.
Thank you.
Thank you. We would request participants to please limit your questions to two per participant. For any further questions, you may come back for a follow-up. The next question is from the line of Nidesh Jain from Investec. Please go ahead.
Thanks again for the opportunity, sir. So on distribution, we are seeing that we have tried to realign our strategy, where we are trying to protect our market share in the affluent segment. So, but in the middle segment, what exactly we are doing to target that segment? Are we targeting tier 2, tier 3 cities? What exactly we are doing, and what exactly which channels we are focusing on?
So, Nidesh, it's a multi-pronged strategy, both channel slash distributor-led as well as customer-led. Of course, at a broad level, it is true that tier 2, tier 3 is slightly lower segment, but in reality, even in the top cities, you do have you know, less affluent customers. Similarly, in tier 2, tier 3 also you have more affluent customers. So the idea is to actually use an appropriate mix of product as well as the right channel to reach these kind of guys. So clearly, you know, there is a large number of, just to get a little bit of more detail, there's a large number of agents who are probably more tuned to selling to the less affluent segment or the mass segment, where you know, the focus has increased through better or rather more appropriate products as well as maybe more appropriate push. But similarly, I would say in every channel that strategy is playing out, whether it is in bank, whether it is in proprietary Salesforce, or indeed some of our other partners. The idea is to show people the value that we can provide by products which are more appropriate to this segment, and then encourage distributors who have access to these to go for it. So we are starting to see encouraging results actually across all channels. It's not necessarily limited to a particular channel.
And so does that mean that the share of traditional products in our savings business will move upwards from here onwards?
It potentially can, but as we've been saying, look, our strategy has been to have a good set of products in every segment. Then it's actually up to distributors to sell what they want to sell.
Sure. That's it from my side.
Thank you.
The next question is from the line of Abhishek Saraf from Deutsche Bank. Please go ahead.
Yeah, hi. Thanks for taking my question. So, sir, previously we had articulated that in terms of product mix, so it was kind of a soft guidance that for the forthcoming year, the protection share could be at around 12%. And for ULIP, we were actually looking at around 75% from the currently 80%, and the remaining 13% coming from the traditional products. So, sir, my question is that are we maintaining that kind of product mix guidance as such? And secondly, with regard to the ULIP ticket size,
Abhishek, can I just address that first? I don't think we have ever given any guidance on the expected product mix for next year. Except that to say the protection business mix, we are seeking to get it into double digits of the product mix as soon as we can.
Okay. Fair enough, sir. And second was on the ULIP bit. So effectively, the ticket size has again gone up. So is it fair to assume that because the markets were more buoyant in fourth quarter and third quarter were rather subdued, so is it also a function of the market movement? Because earlier we thought that we were taking a very proactive stance in actually lowering the ticket size so that we are able to target a certain set of customers. So are the customer, the higher net worth customers coming back? And so just your view on that, and how will this pan out? And will this actually have some bearing on the ULIP share as such?
So Abhishek, just to clarify, the intention was never ever to lower the ticket size. You know, that is actually just an outcome. The idea was, and we have very clearly articulated, we are very good in the affluent segment where we have high ticket size. We want to continue to invest in that. We want to continue to grow our business there. But at the same time, in the mass and mass affluent, our penetration was less. And hence, we wanted to widen our customer base as well as distribution base and actually activate distributors who are probably more appropriate for that segment, but we were maybe not paying them enough attention. And hence, through this process of widening certain segments while at the same time deepening the value segment, we hope to get growth, which is effectively what we have got in Q4. And hence, the outcome is what you are seeing in terms of the average premium, which is higher than Q3. But on an overall basis, if you see the, you know, on that slide, actually you can see that virtually every category, it's not just ULIP. So, you know, just to address your question on markets, yes, markets help, but it's not just because of that. Actually, in every category, we've given you the ticket size in PAR, non-PAR protection. We've seen decent improvement.
One last question, if I can. So just wanting to understand the philosophy behind truing up the persistency assumptions. So effectively, we've always run below the actual persistency experience, and we have always maintained that we would keep reviewing the persistency experience, and someday we'll actually true that up. So what would be the trigger in which case probably you'll see then in your actual assumptions you'll raise the persistency? Is there some kind of spread that you want to maintain, or is it some kind of duration of persistency improvement after which probably we can expect the formal assumptions changes in your EV calculation?
Abhishek, I really cannot specify what will be the formula from a trigger perspective, but nothing has changed in terms of philosophy. The thinking still remains that experience has to sustain for a meaningful period and give us comfort before we start reflecting it in the assumptions.
Okay. Thanks, Dr.
Thanks.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Nischint Chawate from Kotak Securities. Please go ahead.
Hi. Can you give us the data? Can you give us the number for group savings?
You can work it out from the numbers that are there, Nishin. There is a total group APE and there is a protection number, so you can actually back that out. I can give it to you offline.
Sure. I just missed one part. What was the reason for higher advertising expenses?
It's been consistent with what we have been seeing in the last, in fact, 4 or 5 quarters. It's been no different, mainly for protection business.
And just one last thing is, any guidance on margins for the savings business?
We're not given any guidance on margin, Nishant. What we have only articulated is an aspiration on absolute VNB over a period of time.
Okay, great. Thank you very much. I'll take the rest of the questions offline.
Thank you.
Thanks, Nishant.
Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, we'll take the last question from the line of Abhinav Vinod from HSBC. Please go ahead. Abhinav Vinod from HSBC, your line is unmuted.
Hello, this is Vinod Rajani from HSBC. My question was on this new life product guidelines. Anything you're seeing which could be of interest in terms of in terms of future outcomes as far as product strategy and distribution?
Vinod, the new guidelines are not yet public. From the last draft that we had seen, I don't think there was any dramatic change, but we will wait to see the final regulation before we make a sense of it.
Okay. Yeah.
Thanks, Anand.
Thank you. Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, that was the last question. I now hand the conference over to the management for closing comments.
This is Kanan here. Thank you once again to all of you for attending this call. And sorry for delayed start. I'm sure that bulk of the questions we've been able to answer on the call. If there are any other questions for any follow-up conversation you want to have, Satyan and team are really available to take all your queries offline. Thank you once again and good night.